of people are down there, but we have a good crowd here for this small room, and it's good to see everybody here. My topic tonight is William Bingham II, philanthropist, and I'd like to start off by several things. I first visited this house when I was 7 or 8 years old, and have a fascination, lifetime fascination with William Bingham II, because my grandmother was the cook for 8 years here, from 1948 to 1954, so I recall visiting the house many times. I had my first ride in the elevator right around the corner here, and my first ride ever in an elevator, and she took me up to the second floor and pointed out Mr. Bingham's room, and I always wanted to see Mr. Bingham, but I never saw him. He frequently visited my grandmother. He would come down to the kitchen and talk with her by the hour. And her diary, which we have for all those years, is filled with all kinds of references to what was going on in the Bingham household. And Mr. Bingham was sick at times or wasn't feeling right, and so all those things are recorded there as well. I'm grateful to several people who have helped me gather further information on Will Bingham. Laurel Blossom, Will Bingham's grandniece, spent a week with me in Cleveland last April, and she opened a number of doors, particularly the Payne Archives at the Western Reserve Historical Society, and she got me hooked up with Chris Ivan, even though he was gone that week, unfortunately. He did, the Payne Archives, he did bring all the material on William Bingham out for me to see, and left me all kinds of little directions of things to look at. So. He was very helpful. Laurel also introduced me to Charlie Bolden, grandson of the Congresswoman Frances Payne Bolden, Mr. Bingham's sister, and of course she was a member of a friend of Margaret Chase Smith's. He was very gracious and allowed me to photocopy all kinds of things, and so I came home with about a foot high pile of photocopies, thanks to Charlie Bolden and the Western Reserve Historical Society. I also want to thank the late Robert T. Barr of the Bingham Trust, who gave me one of 14, I felt really privileged, one of 14 copies that he made of his history of the Bingham Trust, with a proviso that it was not to be made available for reading by anyone other than myself until the year 2000. So. One of the reasons I want to do this, because there was lots of good information in his little history. And then finally to Margaret Joy Tibbetts, who with our several chats, helped me form some of my ideas about William Bingham II and his times. Much of what I'm going to say tonight is still very tentative, and we don't know, I may have some different opinions by the time I finish looking at his life and times. There's lots of material I haven't looked at, the more sources I need to find, and so I'm going to be talking, and what I say tonight may change as time goes on. I'm still learning much about him, and I need more time to digest all the information I've gathered. I hope to publish something in the near future, but must do much more research, and Eva Bean's word, a lot more digging. I once heard from Cindy Davidson that all of William Bingham's papers were stored in the Bethel garages where the condos are now, were destroyed. But I don't think that's true, because when I got to Cleveland about 1993, I inquired about William Bingham's papers, and the Bolden family had just transferred them temporarily to the Western Reserve Historical Society in Cleveland. And they didn't know what was going to happen to them. And a few years later, they sent me a finding aid, and they had been transferred to Western Reserve. And so many of the ones I looked at Western Reserve are papers that must have been in that garage, or copies of them, certainly, because they related to the many people who wanted assistance in one way or another from William Bingham. William Bingham II, who we have here, and probably taken in the 1930s, was a ninth generation American, all the way down from Thomas Bingham of Windham, Connecticut. He was the second child of five of Charles William and Mary Payne Bingham of Cleveland, Ohio. William Bingham's mother was the daughter of U.S. Senator Henry B. Payne, who lived from 1810 until 1896, a Democrat who ran for president in 1876, 1880, and 1884. Obviously didn't do well, because he never became president, but he thought he was a presidential material. His mother's brother was Oliver Hazard Payne, who never married, was born in Cleveland in 1839, and died in 1917. And he also was reclusive, like William Bingham, so there may have been a family gene there that came out with various generations. And in this generation, it was William Bingham, and his generation was Oliver Hazard Payne. Payne attended Yale, but he left to serve in the Civil War, was wounded at Chickamauga, but returned to the front to lead troops and was commissioned a colonel while he was in his mid-20s. After the war, Colonel Payne returned to Cleveland, where he joined his brother Nathan Payne in the oil business before John D. Rockefeller, who had gone to high school with Oliver, started Standard Oil. The Payne brothers' oil interests were later merged with those of Rockefeller. After the merger, Payne served as treasurer of Standard Oil, where he received credit for making Rockefeller very rich. He later left with large stock holdings to New York and went on to found the American Tobacco Company, the Great Northern Paper Company, and the Tennessee Coal and Iron Company. He was also involved heavily in railroad development as well. Colonel Payne owned the Aphrodite, the largest steam yacht in the United States that sailed the world. He gave millions to help found the Cornell Medical College, also more millions to the Lakeside Hospital in Cleveland, the Yale, and the New York Public Library. When he died in 1917 at the age of 17, he left the bulk of his estate valued at some $179 million, imagine what that was worth today, to trust to two nieces and four nephews. Chris Ivan told me Colonel Payne was the second wealthiest man in the United States after Rockefeller at the time of his death in 1917. William Bingham received some $17 million as his share of this legacy that would make his later philanthropic endeavors possible. But Will Bingham was born to wealth and position in Cleveland. His father, Charles William Bingham, was a wealthy and prominent citizen of Cleveland. Charles Bingham had graduated from Yale in 1868. He was remarkably bright and had a proficiency for languages. Despite a very busy life, he continued to read aloud a page of Latin, Greek, French, and German each day. So that's all interesting what you learn about him. He was very athletic as well at Yale. He engaged in rowing, baseball, fencing, also loved good music, and played the violin. He was also fond of travel, and he toured the South to see the damage of the Civil War while it was still visible. He traveled through Europe, studied French and German, was in Paris at the time of the Franco-Prussian War of 1870. Despite his artistic temperament, he also had a real zest for business. He returned to the United States and resumed study for an MA at Yale. His first job, however, out of Yale was with the Cleveland Iron Company. By 1879, however, he was a member of the W. Bingham, this is his grandfather and company, wholesale hardware and metals. Also involved in oat processing companies, the Wampum Coal and Iron Company, and from 1881 until his death, he was president of Standard Tool Company. He was director of several banks and president of the Perry Payne Company. So you see, he was not a shrinking violet. He was a Republican, an exacting man, observant, very analytical, well-educated, very intellectual. He was a trustee of the Western Reserve Historical Society from 1892 until his death. He was treasurer of the Case Library, trustee of the Lakeview Cemetery, and involved in the arts, and was on the committee to build the Cleveland Museum of Art, one of the country's leading art museums today. And remember, Liberty Holden of Gould Academy fame, of Holden Hall fame, was the chairman of the committee which built the Cleveland Museum. So these two men must have known each other well. He was active in philanthropy, but usually was very anonymous in his gifts. He gave quite a bit of money to the Cleveland Manual Training School in 1926. And his four children combined, the four surviving children, combined to give a dormitory to Yale in his honor. And Will and Charles also gave, later on, to the Case School of Applied Science, now Case Western Reserve, the Charles W. Bingham Mechanical Engineering Building. If you go to Case Western Reserve, you'll still see it there. I saw it when I was there. He took great interest also in his personal library, spent a lot of time reading books and talking about books, and continued to read books systematically through his library. He'd rotate them around so he'd have continue to read them all his life. He died in Cleveland in 1929, and Mary was very much, his wife was Mary, was very much, spent much of her time traveling to take Oliver, the oldest child, to the west and the south for his health, and some of the other children often went with her. So Charles always stayed home in Cleveland to run the family businesses. Charles' oldest son, Oliver, of course, would die in 1898, and his wife in 1900. So this was going to be two blows that William Bingham II would never recover from. He was a frail child who grew up in the midst of an intense activity family. His aunt, Flora Whitney, was in Washington much of the time as hostess of presidents and members of cabinet officials, and was a favorite of Oliver Hazard Payne. His father, grandfather, and uncles were men of action and famous. But even as a boy, he was reclusive and preferred to stay at home in the house, play his violin, abstaining from the rough boyhood games. His family considered him a hypochondriac and chided him for reading so much while schoolmates played baseball. He did on occasion go hunting and canoeing with a friend named Gardner Abbott. His sister Frances told Dr. Jean Curran, a longtime consultant for the Bingham program, that Will, as he was called in the family, had no interest in girls in high school, that his manner of life was puritanical, and that he was critical of some of his free and easy ways of his companions at the university school in Cleveland. The family decided to send him, because of his unhappy experience in Cleveland at the university school, to St. Paul's School in Concord, New Hampshire, as an 11th grader, but that did not work out very well either, because he did not like prep school life. And at St. Paul's, he contracted typhoid fever and was seriously ill for months. He went through a great crisis when both his mother, whom he adored, and his older brother, Oliver, whom he worshipped, hero worship, were also died within 2 years of each other. He didn't do much of anything for a time, giving up any idea of going to college, and stayed home and played the violin. After a while, the family encouraged him to join the family hardware business, but you can imagine what his reaction was to that. He had no interest in that at all. One day, Mrs. Bolden said, her father came home from work after a particularly hard day and saw Will relaxing in the music room playing his violin. The elder Bingham became so enraged at seeing his son playing the role of dilettante while the rest of the family were engaged in a multitude of activities, that he snatched the violin and smashed it across the piano. That proved to be a traumatic episode in the life of a supersensitive young man. It has been commonly thought, however, that this was the end of their relationship between father and son. But when I looked at the papers available at the Payne Archives in Cleveland, there are a number of very affectionate letters. We don't see Will's side of things, but we see his father's letters to Will. And he always signs of affectionately yours, and he's always giving him advice and trying to be helpful to him and empathizing with his emotional problems. And I think the fact that they jointly gave the Charles Bingham Engineering Building at Case Western Reserve is a good example. This happened in the 1920s, a good example that they did not completely break relations. But Will did leave home and wandered, and he went into a world of his own contrivance. He spent one winter in a Nova Scotia logging camp. I've always wondered how this all happened. I would need to know a lot more about this. Where he spent his evenings playing the violin to the woods crew. Can you imagine that? I just think that's one of the great... And in the papers, there's a reference to a man that he hears about later on, and he does recall very fondly that they spent the winter in this logging camp. So I need to know more about him. That's one thing I need to learn more about. Another area he loved was the Jackson Hole region of Wyoming. Here he spent hours riding the rugged trails in the midst of some magnificent mountain scenery. For several winters, he went to Santa Barbara, California. In later years, his Bethel home housed a varied collection of paintings which captured the glory of his favorite Western scenes. And I think after his death, the library received one of those paintings that used to be over the mantelpiece. I don't know what it still is or not, but it's one of those that was a very well-known artist of today, so I think quite valuable. He did not lack funds during this period, having had money given him by members of the family, including his mother and his uncle Oliver. He would return to Cleveland from time to time, but then traveled extensively. As time went on, he became convinced that he needed help, and in 1911, at the age of 32, along with Cleveland friend William J. Upson, came to Bethel and placed himself under the care of Dr. John George Gehring, having heard of this nationally famous clinic, undoubtedly through his Cleveland connections. Gehring, of course, was from Cleveland as well. He hoped that Gehring's therapy of swimming in Millbrook pool, sawing and chopping wood, weeding gardens, feeding chickens, walking and snowshoeing in the woods would improve his health and outlook. And Dr. Gehring drew Bingham into a lively crowd of friendly young people. The local hotel near the common was the setting of many frequent parties. When the hotel was destroyed in 1911, Bingham was with four other Gehring patients, formed a corporation to build and operate a new Bethel Inn, which opened in 1913. This arrangement continued until 1928, when Bingham became the sole owner. He soon found that he had not only acquired the help he needed, but good friends as well with the Gehrings. Gehring became the father figure to him that he had lost with his own father, and Marion True Gehring, the mother he had lost to death. He decided to settle Bethel after conferring with his father. There's one letter where he talks about, asks his father's advice and whether he should settle in Maine, whether that would be a good thing for him. His father says yes. So, he registers to vote and becomes a citizen of Bethel. Here he was encouraged by the Gehrings to take interest in Gould Academy. Mrs. Gehring's father, remember, had started Gould Academy, and it was inevitable that she would interest him in Gould. And remember, Dr. Gehring was the president of the Board of Trustees, so he was very interested in making sure that Mr. Bingham understood what Gould's needs were. Of course, at that time, Gould was in very serious trouble and was not doing well at all. Bingham even conquered some of his shyness and played the violin at the school, including one for the memorial service, Liberty Holden, with his sister Frances playing the piano. After 1917, when he received his share of the Payne Trust, he became the financial angel for the school, giving it five major buildings in his lifetime, others through the foundations after his death he created. And appropriately, he became a trustee in 1917 and continued for his life, the rest of his life. In the 1920s, he bought an extra mountains, an entire mountainside to protect the watershed of his adopted town and gave it to the Bethel Water Company. In 1922, he bought this house, 1921 he bought this house, and in 1922 he had it altered using plans adapted by the Boston architectural firm of Coolidge and Carlson. In 1925, there was a newspaper article indicating that he paid more than $200,000 in income tax, the largest single taxpayer in Maine. This brought the world to his door and pushed him to a life of seclusion. Here he lived for the rest of his days, from June to October. As winter approached each year, he would begin the trek south, first to the Ritz Hotel in Boston, then on to the Carolinas at Pinehurst, then to Ormond and Daytona Beach, and finally to his winter headquarters, the Hotel Flamingo in Miami Beach, Florida. He was usually accompanied by a nurse. Later he had three, as he never wanted to be alone without someone on call. Moving into his own house in Bethel also allowed him the privacy that became so guarded in later life. His isolation was only broken by hiding behind curtains to listen to doctors Farnsworth and Walters interview prospective people for his generosity. He also hid behind trees to peer out at the golf course to see who was there. He continued his friendship with the Gehrings and Laurie Ellery Park. Gould and the Bethel Inn became his great interest in Bethel. During the 1920s, he began the Bingham Scholars Program to help young men and women who were short of funds continue their education. Their names were confidential and the recipients never saw it. The applications for these students usually were Dr. Gehring, and then followed by his stepson, Dr. John Farnsworth, and finally by Dr. Arthur Wallace. Among the most famous of the Bingham Scholars are Edmund S. Muskie, who we all know, Dr. Victor McCusick, chairman of the medicine at Johns Hopkins University, and his twin brother, we all know, Vincent McCusick, who was Chief Justice of the Maine Supreme Court, and many others. He had a remarkable memory and recalled the names of hundreds of people he had helped. Dr. Guerin closed his clinic in 1925, and in 1930, suffering with angina, he asked his wife's son, Dr. George Farnsworth, to come and help Will handle his affairs. Since Dr. Farnsworth's expertise was in obstetrics, a Florida physician was engaged, Dr. Arthur Walters, to handle Will's medical situation. Dr. Guerin's heart problems prompted consideration of the ways to improve medical services in rural areas, primarily in Maine. This led to the Bingham Associates Fund, which made quite an impact in Maine and in the Boston area. The establishment of the Bingham Associates Fund required legal assistance. This led to the hiring of Sidney Davidson, a 30s lawyer, 30-odd years old, as Will's personal lawyer. The United States Trust Company also entered the picture at this time and continues to this day to handle some of the Bingham Foundation's money. In 1935, Davidson suggested the creation of the William Bingham Second Trust for Charity with an initial gift of $5,000. Today it's over $50 million, so you see how it's grown. From 1932 to 1941, Bingham money financed schools, Hanscom Hall, Holden Hall, Farnsworth Fieldhouse, and Athletic Field, and in Boston, the Pratt Diagnostic Hospital, which became the base of the Bingham Associates Medical Program. During this time, Bingham's circle of advisors came to include Joseph Barr and Dr. Samuel Prager, who, under Bingham Associates Fund, became a motivating force in the improvement of medical care in Maine. Dr. Farnsworth, who replaced his stepfather, Dr. Guerin, as chief advisor to Will, was aloof and had a very aristocratic manner that precluded the close friendship and relation and friendly relationship he'd had with the miracle man of Bethel. Life became lonelier for this very lonely man. And I would say, Margaret was quite emphatic that life was kind of boring here. There was, in fact, if anybody stopped by, I think the staff, light came in their eyes a little bit because there was something happening here. It was pretty dull and deadly here. And I don't think Will ever did very much. He, you know, he read all these letters and of appreciation and that sort of thing, but nothing happened here very, it wasn't a very full impact place. It was kind of a leisurely, you know, things happened and everything was focused on Will Bingham's health and his ability to function. And so it was a relatively laid back place, and probably when anybody came, it was sort of a break in this monotony, which was very clearly here. And Margaret was, I think, very emphatic in describing what it was like here. It must have been very, very tough to be in this place because, and you have to work for Mr. Bingham because it was always, you know, always was very focused on him and how he was going to be. During World War I and World War II, however, Bethel assumed a very prominent role in the sale of war bonds, largely due to the support of William Bingham II. He bought enormous numbers of bonds and, of course, made Bethel look very good as a town supporting the war. Loneliness became even more clear after the war. The violin was put away, and he listened to music only through his favorite records. He never appeared at any social gatherings. In fact, at the one time we know he appeared at Gould in those later years was the 1950s. The campus had to be cleared of anyone, so he would not see anybody, and no one would see him. The local taxi drove him down to Gould in front of what is now Bingham Hall. It was the gymnasium at that time. And Ed Vashon walked with him into the women's gym. And at the stage, there was a beautiful set that this woman named Beverly Onofrio, who was a member of the society, had done. And he took one look at it and pronounced it very fine and turned around and left. So he spent very little time at Gould. He spent all his money and so much of his interest was in Gould, but he rarely appeared on campus, and when he did, it was a very limited exposure, as you can see. He gave up his car and chauffeur, and of course he never owned a car. He always gave the chauffeur $7,000 to buy a new packet whenever one was needed. So that was how that was handled. He rarely ventured out on his grounds, and if he did, he was always accompanied by a nurse. He did follow the programs of the progress of people he had helped obtain education and health care. He was very often canceled educational loans. Personally, he lived rather frugally. And one of the things my, I know Bob Hastings always laughed about it because he cautioned my grandmother about spending too much money on household expenses because he was wanted to live very frugally. And he cautioned her on spending too much money on food. He avoided Cleveland and its painful memories. But Mrs. Baldwin continued to be the only member of the family that came to visit him and spent much time with him. Dr. Walters became his closest friend after Dr. Farnsworth dies in 1947. Dr. Walters takes over, and he's a very genial, friendly man, not the arrogant SOB that George Farnsworth was. And one of the things that you learn, it is most incredible to see all his Farnsworth's comments about people and about motivations of people and his ideas of things. We'll talk about it a little bit later, but it's a very interesting part of the papers to see all these comments, Dr. Farnsworth. And of course, he's very insistent that Gould be Gentiles only. I mean, the Gould, Bethlehem be Gentiles only, you see, so, which I don't think Will Bingham would have shared, but anyway, this is one of the things he insisted. No Jews allowed at the Bethlehem. William Bingham, of course, had his closest friend, Dr. Wallace, and Dr. Wallace visited him twice each day, morning and afternoon, and they discussed business or whatever personal matters William Bingham needed to talk about. William Bingham, ironically, died of cancer in February 17, 1955, with Dr. Wallace and Mrs. Boland at his bedside, and is buried in Cleveland, of course, but one of the things he was terrified of was cancer. And any letter that came in from a cancer patient had to be retyped because he was afraid he'd get some germ from that. So, and so ironically, he died of cancer. So, after his death, the residue of his estate was used to establish the Bingham Betterment Fund. And his sister, Elizabeth Blossom, placed her inheritance from her brother in a foundation named for him, the William Bingham Foundation. And following her death, a large portion of her estate was added to the reserves of that foundation. So William Bingham has remembered in three different foundations, which I think is quite unusual. A few philanthropists have three foundations created from their wealth and in their memory. And after his death, William Simpel, president of the United States Trust of New York, wrote to William Bingham's youngest brother, Harry, "I know of no man of similar wealth who has accomplished as much with his money as your brother Will Bingham has." And I think that's an interesting little tribute to Will. But one of the things that I think is interesting about the whole Bingham thing is some of the things that Will Bingham's money was spent on and some of the reaction to him by people who knew what was going on. Just prior to the American entry into World War II, Dr. Farnsworth, who had ties with Maine's ultra-conservative Ralph Owen Brewster, the United States Senator from Maine. And Brewster had all these conspiratorial theories about the communists taking over Maine and the nation. And Farnsworth shared some of those ideas. And so, due to Farnsworth's prodding, he hired this man, Hugh S. Kelly, who with Bingham money, and to go around and gather information on the various labor organizers and people who were not WASP, various ethnic groups, and looking for the communist cell. It must be there. And it's wonderful reading because you read all these wonderful reports and he has absolutely nothing to say that's really, you know, that interesting as far as what he was finding when he's visiting, trying to find out who these people were, whether they were communists or not. And he spends $75. He pays this man $75 a week, which at that time, this is late 30s, early 40s, and $25 for his expenses. So you can see that over $100 a week for nothing. And of course, the only thing that stops this thing is the gas ration comes in 1942, and that sort of ends it all. So he no longer can do that. But it's incredible. One of those incredible things in the Bingham papers is quite interesting. The Bingham papers also contain lots of letters to Farnsworth from Rumford social worker June Hills Hunter. And you gather that the old boy must have liked her because he must have had a high the women or something, but anyway, he liked her because he is quite jovial and quite friendly in his letters to her, but almost everybody else he's just very abrupt and very autocratic, as you can imagine. And of course, the real heroine in all this is Betty Burns Thurston, who was the individual who reported to Drs. Farnsworth and Walters about cases that needed attention, both in money for education and help with medical expenses. And Betty was one of those people who was the soul of discretion, and both doctors knew she knew a lot more than she reported. And they often, every once in a while, the little, we know you know a lot more about this than you're telling us, but we know you can't tell us anything more. But anyway, it's very interesting to see how she appears here, and quite often she's outlining the situations in Bethel and the area. And she knows what's going on. If she doesn't know, she finds out. She's a real sleuth, and she is giving him all kinds of information about people who need help from William Bingham. Now, one of the things that I found interesting is a letter which was written by Ed Garing, who would be a nephew of Dr. John George Garing. And this letter is quite blunt about what this side of the Garing family felt was going on with Dr. Garing and Marion True Garing and George, and they don't like any of them, and this is sort of interesting to see what they have to say, because I think it's quite interesting. It says, enclosed here where they will find a small check for your birthday, be taken with my congratulations or commiserations as you feel at the time, and the bulletin of the main center, the medical center, this is a medical book bulletin, financed by, not George Farnsworth, by Will Bingham II, who got caught in the net of the Wizard of the Androscoggin years ago, and up to the time of Geordie's death, had not been able to extricate himself. The story surpasses those of the Arabian Nights. 30 or more years ago, a young man with some mental quirks, it is reported, a fortune of $86 million, wandered from Cleveland to Bethel to place him under the beneficial care of the pioneer of psychiatry, Dr. John George Garing. This was a juicy morsel for George and Marion. They really got their teeth into that one and managed successfully to hold him over for the Fauntleroy, who went to town regarding Bingham's money in a big way, as you will note by reading the bulletin. You probably know that Marion True Garing's name stands out boldly in gold letters on the front street side of the big girls' dormitory, one of the group of beautiful buildings connected with Gould Academy. In the school's large assembly hall, facing the pupils as they sit in their seats, is an oil painting of the Dr. Garing and his head and bust. The big athletic house on the opposite side of the street from the academy, large enough for indoor baseball practice, is known as the Farnsworth House or Gymnasium, whereas the real gym, standing next to the academy building, is called the William Bingham Gymnasium. This is written in 1949. It is a much less pretentious structure than either of the other buildings mentioned. Of course, George went to the Harvard Medical School, where one sharpshooter ever on the alert for boys among whose acquaintances and friends millionaires might be counted, one Joseph Pratt, M.D., made himself very congenial and helped this young man in a big city and so far from home. And George fell for his flattery and attention hook, line, and sinker. When J.G. was ill, this is John George Garing, was ill, Pratt flew to Bethel to go to the aid of a colleague. He didn't exactly push the venerable psychiatrist through death's door, but the poor old man died, and Pratt, having all this time, got himself into Bingham's and J.G.'s and Georgie's of good graces, came away with sufficient funds to build the Joseph H. Pratt Diagnostic Hospital in Boston and to maintain their paid staff, of which he is one in perpetuity. I have met and know Pratt for years. He attends the annual meetings of the Maine Medical Association. He's a smooth operator. But Joe had not finished with Geordie with his Pratt's name when his Pratt's name was up for all the time in a beautiful brick building in Boston. He needed a surgical wing to his diagnostic clinic, and he knew that George had complete control of Bingham's philanthropies. Two and two make four. No sooner said than done. He called George's attention to this crying need, which, if it were created, would bear George's name for all time. He, Pratt, would personally see to that. Once again, Georgie made a nosedive, and behold, the Farnsworth surgical building on page 5 of the bulletin. all these years since J.G.'s death in 1932, this fellow Georgie, whom J.G. called a fool in conversation with me, was drawing down at the late Ellery C. Park's, according to the late Ellery C. Park, $75,000 yearly for directing Bingham's philanthropy. So in federal, $75,000 was in the 1940s. I have no idea, no desire to detract from any ability George may have had. He was 4 years younger than I when I was at the Garing House in Bethel. He couldn't drive a nail or harness a horse or distinguish a weed from a desired plant to save his soul. And yet without any mechanical ability, he was called to Cleveland to become assistant professor of obstetrics at Western Reserve University. And when his stepfather died, he relinquished obstetrics pronto to become the business manager for a multimillionaire, never had a day's business training or experience. Naturally, the credit for the many desirable things Bingham's money has accomplished really belongs first to the man who made it and then gave it to Bingham. Next, it belongs to Bingham, and next to J.G. for holding the man over the years. And the names that are ever blazoned for posterity to see are Pratt, Farnsworth, and Marion Tregaring. In the future, most persons who read these names won't know that Bingham existed. George Garing, you will recall, was the sickly one of grandfather's brood, who had to be sent to bed early for his rest, while our father had to hold a candle for the old man to dress his cattle into the wee hours of the morning. George died in the 70s, a faker, our father at 38 of tuberculosis, but all honest men. Don't forget Marion, she had much to do, I'm sure, with making George and Geordie stuffed shirts and crooked, but she had good material to work with. P.S. This is not sour grapes, as ever yet. So that concludes the story, but you can see that there were other views of the Garings and the Bingham philanthropies. Anybody have any questions?
I can't remember if Bingham had like a real job or something.
No, he never did. He never did work in the house.
He never
worked anywhere. So.
When was he born?
1879, and died in 1955.
Stanley, is it true he came to Bethel in a railroad car, private railroad
car? Yes, he came to Bethel in a private railroad car, yes, that's right. Yeah.
I can remember that Dad had to go down with the ambulance to meet the train, and he'd get up and lie down on the, when they got the car out, he'd lie down on it then. He was all right, but then they brought him up to his house.
Yeah, he was.
Stanley, I can see from the age of a lot of people here that they knew about William Bingham when they were younger, and he had some impact on their life.
Yeah.
I think it would be interesting, if that's true, for people to tell what they knew about William Bingham growing up. I know my folks have been, the Hastings family, have been here for 205 years. And my father, Bob Hastings, was on the board at Gould. And we always heard about Bingham.
Yeah.
And I remember when I started Gould, Elwood Island, the principal, said, I'm probably the only principal in all of the United States that can say this, but if you want to go to college and you keep your grades up, Mr. Bingham will see that you go through.
That's right.
And I hadn't realized that Vince McCusick and,
Ed Muskie
were also the people who, he went outside of Bethel.
Anybody in Maine, he first Bethel and Oxford County and then Maine, you see. He was very interested in Maine people being.
And I think it's interesting that as sickly as he was, he built a gymnasium. And George and I went to Gould Bates College.
Right.
And he also built a gymnasium there.
Right.
He was interested.
At the time of his death, he was the largest Bates donor at that time.
Is that right?
Yeah, at the time. And you look at the Coolidge and Carlson did the buildings here. They also did the buildings at Bates. You see, a lot of similarities between Chase Hall and the field house at Bates. There's a lot of similarities.
Chase,
you look at it, and there's a lot of similarities. Yeah, Chase Hall, and the spires are much like the ones over here on the Bethlehem garages. You see, so. And so there's a lot of similarities between the two buildings. And he was a major donor to Bates. So at the time of his death, he was the largest donor Bates had had. So.
And is it true that that if somebody's house burned down and they were desperate and needed money, that an anonymous check would arrive?
Very often. You read Betty Burns Thurston. She's very good at finding what's going on in the community and making sure something happens, you see. So it's interesting to see how that whole system works. But it's Betty Burns, one of the things I really wish I'd known, you see, one of the things you regret when you get older. See, my grandmother took care of Betty Burns Thurston the last years of her life. So I, as a high school student, would go have lunch with my mother with my grandmother, and dinner or something, and Betty Burns Thurston was there. And I knew she had something to do with Bingham, but I didn't know what she did. And I wish I'd asked her some questions, because she probably, I don't know if she told me anything, but it was interesting to see how often I saw her. And of course she, and was my grandmother was there when she died. So, and she, but Betty Burns Thurston never wanted anyone to know how old she was. And so you go over to her grave at Riverside Cemetery and you won't see any dates. She was terrified anyone would know. She was probably in her 90s, but no one would ever know her dates. So.
Well, my father always said that anonymous checks arrived, but I don't think I ever realized who was doing it. I mean, who sent him the information?
Yeah. Betty would talk to either Dr. Wallace or Farnsworth, and that's, something would happen, you see, that way. And there'd be this discussion. One of the things I hope that, I'm sure there's more papers that were in existence at one time, but there's a good sample of, you know, what was happening in Bethel. I arrived that day at Western Reserve, and I started in. There was just a whole Bethel thing, and I was right in Bethel, and I thought I was in Bethel, you know, again, and here, and now all of a sudden I woke up, and I said, I'm in Western Reserve, Cleveland. I couldn't believe, you know, what I was seeing, because all this Bethel stuff, all these Bethel names, and everything made so much sense, and there's some wonderful stuff there, but it's just a matter of, some of it's fairly, you know, still kind of confidential, in a sense, because there's people still alive, but obviously I'm not going to do anything with it till, you know, later on, if anything at all. So, and change, not leave any, put any names in, but it's some wonderful stuff there, what was happening with people all over the area. So, any other questions or comments? So, anybody? Okay, yeah.
I do remember being out on the lawn over there playing with some friends, because my grandmother worked at Bethel Inn.
Right.
Young children. And this man came along and was said, well, you can't play here because it's, you know, this is private property. And Bingham stepped out and yelled at him to leave us alone.
Right.
That's the only thing I remember.
It's quite interesting also in the Bingham papers to see. Quite often, George Farnsworth will say, you know, give $100. Well, Bingham will cross it out and put $200. So, it's quite often how he's more generous than Farnsworth ever was. And Farnsworth, of course, was constantly telling him he couldn't spend as much money as he thought he could. You know, he was always asking. Probably make sure his salary stayed up there, you know, sometimes. It's constantly there. One of the things I find interesting is I didn't know until much later that my grandfather, who had a meat cart and wandered around Bethel with a meat cart, he was a good friend of William Bingham's. And Bingham, I think, had this, you know, just had this ability to relate to people of all stations, even though they were, you know, below his station. And I never knew this until much later. Mrs. Tibbetts told me that my grandfather and William Bingham were quite friendly. He would always talk to my grandfather, and they always be out to meet him. And of course, there was a period where Bingham was very social, and then, of course, after that, 1920s, when people began to know he was a wealthy man, they began to descend on him, and of course, he began to go into his shell, and that's, we never saw him again after that, so.
Yeah, how old was he at that stage when he kind of went into the shell?
Oh, in the 20s, he was born in, he'd been in his 40s, probably. Mm-hmm. Probably midlife crisis, I believe. He was in his 40s, so he was, and of course, he had a lot of ups and downs in his health, and we don't really know what was wrong with him, but he certainly had lots of ups and downs in his health, and his moods were very, you know, he was very moody, and he didn't know what was going to happen, so he was, but there were some questions about him being drugged. I mean, that's the other thing you heard about him, is he was being drugged by Dr. Farnsworth. I don't know, we don't ever know that, but Margaret confirmed that she'd heard it too by various people saying that he was kept under sedation and drugs and all that sort of stuff. Gehring, there's letters from Gehring, and you find some, Gehring suggested he take various things for his conditions, so, and those are in the letters, so you see that Gehring had some medications he was advising to take, but who knows what he had for medications, we'll probably never know that, but at least it was interesting to see what was happening there.
Is it true that when he came here, Gehring had him chopping wood?
Yeah, that was part of the regimen. You know, you had to, you most of these people were neurotics, and you had to organize them into, and make them sure they had a schedule. and they had activities where they read and they talked about art and that sort of thing, but they also had physical activities. And physical exercise is very important to make them sleep. And then at the evening, you're supposed to have the big meal of the night, and you would dress in your finest clothing and jewelry and come down, and only to talk about cultural things, art and music and that sort of thing, not to talk about yourself or your illnesses or your problems. So there was a Bethel League formed of all those people that were so infatuated with Goering. Goering and his wife, I think, she was a marvelous manager, and I think they were a great team. You see, together they had all kinds of people that they brought to Bethel. And of course, these people paid handsomely, so they made a lot of money and did very well with this clinic. So, any other comments?
Stan, yeah. This has just bugged me for years. I know when Gould shut down to the town kids.
Yeah.
There was a lot of scuttlebutt in town about what it said in Mr. Bingham's will.
Yeah.
That town students should always go to Gould Academy and would not be shut out. Is that true?
I don't think it was in the will, but I've seen several statements where he insists on Bethel being first and that he would always make sure that the school would continue and all that stuff. There's several passages in his own handwriting. I remember seeing those. And it's very clear that that's what he wanted. His interests were the Bethel Inn and Gould Academy. It was his major interest in town, and he really focused on those.
And do you have any way of knowing how much is left of the Bingham money?
Well, there's about $50 million in the Trust for Charity, the Bingham Trust, and there's $50 million in the Betterment Fund, and there's about $25 million in the William Bingham Foundation. So there's probably $125 million, maybe.
How do those different foundations work? What kind of things do they sponsor?
Well, they vary. Of course, the Betterment Fund is probably most active nationally, although the William Bingham Foundation is also a national foundation. The Trust for Charity is moved into their own little orbit in some cases, and they have different priorities now than they used to. But all of them have some interest in Bethel. They all have given something to Bethel, I think. Continue to give things to Bethel, so. Any other questions or comments?
At this point, does the rural medicine program, which foundation does that come under now?
Well, they have the Bingham program now, which is out of Portland, is it, I think? And that has some Bingham money, and I think sort of taken over. The Bingham Associates Fund is now extinct, I think. I don't think it acts. For years, you used to go to the academy. I think you still see the plaque there. It said Bingham, headquarters of the Bingham Associates Fund, but I don't think it actively is operating as it did. And I think the Bingham program now has taken over some of their medical interests. Any other comments or questions?
Well, I took blood from Mr. Bingham.
Was it blue?
I was a recipient of a scholarship to go to lab school, came back to Bethel, and Mr. Bingham was sick. Obviously, it would be a real procedure to take him to a lab with Dr. Walters and Betty Thurston gowning me up with masks, gloves, the works, and me trembling, wondering if I could do this procedure. But it all went smoothly.
Yeah. There's quite a bit of correspondence about a dentist. They brought in his own dentist from Portland. And it would cost $100, and this guy had his assistant with him, and he raised the fee to $200, and George Founders really went after him about it. So you get the impression that there was really something. But having your own dentist, being so insecure in your own social gatherings that you had to have your own dentist, but he brought everybody in as much as possible. His own hair, I think his nurses cut his hair later on after he stopped going out. So it's interesting to see how seclusion became his way of life, how sad he was. I mean, it's really a sad life. I think it's one of the things that you come out of this, had all this money, but really a very sad and lonely life. It was sort of inevitable, I guess, in a sense, but it was sort of a very sad life, very lonely life.
The office where I worked always dealt with Betty
Yeah.
Somebody needed extra medical attention. They paid for it.
Yeah.
Sent them to Boston for.
Yeah. Hundreds of people sent to diagnostic clinic from this, and down there, and all kinds of incredible reports, and they just were just so helpful. And the Rumford Hospital benefited tremendously from
CMG.
And CMG, Rumford particularly also was largely a Bingham product in many ways. Any other comments or questions? We're ready for a fresh one. Oh,
ma'am, just one. Do you know if it was during Mr. Bingham's ownership of the Bethel Inn that several houses and other buildings around the inn were purchased as guest housing? Like the former Grover House on,
most of them were
on Mill Hill,
most of them
and the
were,
old
yeah.
Broad Street schoolhouse, was that?
Yeah.
That was his money that provided
those, yeah.
Reconstruction
was,
of the building?
He bought the Elms over here too, and so and all these buildings. Yeah,
when did he cease being owner of the inn?
1955, when he died. Good time to end, you know. Okay, I guess we are all set. We got some cider and donuts, and stay around for some conversation and questions. Thank you.
Who was it to hire Kelly?
Yeah,
he always called into the house.
Oh, he did?
Yeah.
He did? Really?
He always called.